Hello, I'm Olivia Mattis, and I'm delighted you've elected to spend some of your Sunday with us today. I'm representing the Sousa Mendez Foundation. We honor a rescuer, a hero who in the spring of 1940 saved so many lives as the Portuguese Consul General in Bordeaux, France. For the last several years, we've been holding programs on Sundays, telling beautiful stories of rescue and resistance. And today we have a hero of a very special kind. He is different from many of the heroes we've encountered, and we're going to learn more about him today. His name is Szmul Artur Zygielbojm. Today's program is co-sponsored with the Anne Frank Center USA, and I'm delighted that their CEO is going to moderate today's program, and that's the dynamic Sharon Douglas. I would also like to thank the sponsors of today's program, Mimi and Marvin Sandler, whose generosity allowed many of you to have sponsored tickets today. So many thanks to the Sandlers. Now, Sharon is going to introduce our guests. And so, Sharon, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Olivia. The Anne Frank Center is honored to co-sponsor this wonderful event. The Anne Frank Center has created and continues to educate young people about anti-Semitism, hatred, kindness, and brotherhood with peer-to-peer training, with our exhibits, school programs, and live performances throughout the United States. Anne is a power of one, telling us through her writings in her diary that there is more hope than despair in us, and that hope is the key to keep reaching for something that is good, just good. The Anne Frank Center hopes to inspire the next generation to learn to end all forms of hatred and recognize the dignity of every human being. Today, we are honored to have two distinguished speakers to discuss the life of Szmul Artur Zygielbojm. Dr. Jud Newborn has served as the founding historian of the Museum of Jewish History, New York's Holocaust Museum. He is the author of Sophie Scholl, The White Rose, a now classic story about German resistance heroes. Judge's newest article on The White Rose is in the Smithsonian Magazine, now online only. There's a link to it in the chat if you would like to find out how to read it. Jud has lectured throughout the world, and in 2018, we at the Anne Frank Center honored him with the Spirit of Anne Frank Human Rights, W-R-I-T-E-S, award, and he is now on our advisory council. Dr. Newborn will present a multimedia program weaving his own personal story with the tale of Zygielbojm, the first man to bring news of the Holocaust to the West. He will also share his present-day experience in Auschwitz and Birkenau. Our second lecturer is Dr. Artur Zygielbojm, the grandson of Szmul Artur Zygielbojm. Dr. Zygielbojm is Emeritus Research Associate Professor at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln School of Natural Resources. He has worked at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory and was a member of many space mission teams. Arthur carries the weight of the legacy of his grandfather and will give us his thoughts on the important man. I will now turn the program over to Jud. Jud?
Thank you, Sharon. Definitely. I'm delighted to be here again with the Sousa Mendez Foundation. And I'm going to tell you, in fact, you're about to hear a Hasidic tale of the Holocaust. It is a tale in which none of the protagonists are Hasidic. I think that makes it a postmodern Hasidic tale.
Mm-hmm.
Our tale is also postmodern because it defies time and space, stretching as it does across three continents and from 1897 to 1943 to 1996 to, well, this very moment. For in a sense, we are all part of the unfolding of this tale, even as I speak. Now, I call our tale postmodern because the Holocaust, beginning with Kristallnacht, shattered our faith in modernity, leaving the world and our capacity to explain it in fragments. And yet that doesn't mean I don't have a tale to tell in which everything somehow miraculously comes together. As we have come to expect of all Hasidic tales, this is a story of magical coincidences that result in a flash of deep, profound, and heartfelt wisdom, a wisdom that despite all suffering, affirms life. And like all proper Hasidic tales, the miracle is not fiction, but reality. I'm about to bring alive before your eyes a magical triptych of three true stories. One, Aleph. This is the story about a Polish Jew dead some 80 years, a boy of such humble origins that there would have been no reason on earth to presume that 35 years later, after his birth, he would be breaking news of historic proportions from London in international broadcasts on the BBC. Much less that he would take his own life, almost in the manner of a Buddhist monk, in desperation, setting himself publicly aflame, as it were, so as to rouse the conscience of an indifferent humanity. Two, Base. This is also the story of a young American Jewish man who tramped the same West Hills of Long Island as old Walt Whitman himself did, a boy who later, however, wedded himself to the black hole of the Holocaust and almost lost himself within, only to be saved by a miracle. And finally, Gimel, three. This is the story of a South African Jewish woman from Johannesburg, a champion ballroom dancer who specialized in the rhythms of Latin and swing, and who also just happened to be one of America's most prominent psychoanalysts. Now, how, you well may ask, could these three separate lives possibly intersect? Well, be patient, and you may start to see the threads weaving together into whole cloth, even as you watch and listen. Our triptych begins with the story of that young American Jew. I, Jud Newborn, Yida Neugeboren, am the child of beloved Eastern European grandparents. Now, when I was a boy of five, I found buried under a pile of blankets in my grandmother's bureau drawer, a photograph I had never seen before, a kind of family portrait, it seemed. These mysterious Jewish faces, some older, some younger, were all strange to me, yet somehow familiar. "Who are they, Grandma?" I said, excited by my discovery. "Don't ask," she replied in her warm Yiddish accent, looking away, her face suddenly red, her eyes filled with tears. "Put it back. Hitler burnt them all." For the first time in my life, a hole opened in my gut that smoldered and grew. Only now did I begin to understand what my mother had meant when she said she had always intended to have six children, not just four, six for the 6 million, her own contribution to restore to the Jewish people that which we had lost. But my father and mom's mother-in-law persuaded her to stop after three. Three was modern, her mother-in-law argued, and maybe even one too many, but six? That was practically barbaric, the kind of broods raised in the old country by those who had no choice. The poor, the ignorant, those huddled masses yearning to breathe free. Well, 7 years after I was born, with my father's unknowing help, of course, and yet entirely on her own initiative, my mother conceived a fourth child before it was too late. She named him Kim, or Chaim, life. She hugged him to her breast and loved him as she loved us all. But you know, sometimes I used to see that question flicker silently in her eyes. Where are my other two children? Well, as for me, I only set out to reveal the answer to the greatest mystery of the 20th century, if not all time, the Holocaust. Although considered beyond the limits of human and scientific explanation, I was convinced that the analytical tools of cultural anthropology never applied could explain what theologian Arthur A. Cohen had called aptly the tremendum. And so I became to some degree the equivalent of a feverish Hasidic yeshiva bucher from an earlier century, a student who buries himself in the mysteries of the Kabbalah, seeking out the hidden name of God so as to bring about all by himself the coming of the Messiah, and in the process finds despair or even madness instead. My search for answers led me to Germany, where I lived for nearly 4 years in 1978 and then from 1980 to 1983, based in Munich, not far from the gateway to Dachau, studying the Holocaust, chasing after SS officers in prison and at large to plumb the cultural caverns of their minds. I journeyed to Poland, to Auschwitz-Birkenau in May 1982, 6 months into the Communist Declaration of Martial Law. And along the way also worked undercover for Radio Free Europe. This was before Auschwitz was a place to make TV series or Hollywood films or come on tours and pilgrimage. "Oh, you can stay in Birkenau as long as you like. It doesn't close at dark," the director of the State Museum said to me. And so I trudged along the infamous train track and walked through that forbidding entrance, making my way between the remains of hundreds of barracks and through grasses and innumerable wildflowers high as my waist. Not another soul was there. All was beautiful, all silent, all numb. Suddenly, whir, 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 my heart almost stops. A pheasant breaks from the grass at my feet and flies off low above the horizon. How big this place is, I think. By the time I have made my way to its deepest recess, the remains of crematorium number 5, it is already growing dark. I know I am standing on the site of the ovens, although I can barely see them. I stoop, and in the demi-dark, scrape some soil into a tiny plastic film canister. And then I look up and I realize I am alone. I have to get out of there. I try to stay calm as I walk back toward the gateway of death, the gate through which the incoming transports rolled. I'm calming myself, but I'm also walking faster and faster. Keep calm. But when I do reach the gateway, to my horror, it is shut. I am locked in at night in Auschwitz-Birkenau. Suddenly, I am no longer numb. I feel the ghosts turn. My heart beating wildly, I throw my bag over the 10-foot-high fence, scale the rough wires, then jump over, down, out. Later, I open the film canister in the light in the former SS barracks where I am housed and discover inside, amid the ash, a tiny bone. A doctor tells me later it is the finger bone of a child. Back at the University of Chicago, I appear briefly on national TV and am recruited to help build New York's new Holocaust Museum, the Museum of Jewish Heritage. It is 1986. But by 1990, the museum's plans falter. And in any event, I still have a prior personal obligation to fulfill, to use those anthropological tools of mine to explain the final solution. Hubris? If so, then as the ancient Greeks know, there must be punishment looming. I'm awarded my doctorate with distinction in 1994. But now, at a moment that should have been one of personal triumph, unaccountably, my life begins to implode. I had married myself off to the black hole of the Holocaust, and suddenly I found that all I had for my devotion, my fidelity, was that enormous black hole in the center of my heart, one which grew and grew. I dove into it headlong. Indeed, I had no choice. Where did it lead me? Back somehow, holding on for dear life to the doors of the Museum of Jewish Heritage in Manhattan, which miraculously had found itself reborn in 1995. I am in despair. I hide it so that no one knows. And yet now I must return to the killing fields and death camps to seek out artifacts and plow through those awful memoirs and documents, sifting for pithy quotations. I'll quote only two less gruesome ones. "There our murderers stand in black. On their soiled hands, they wear white gloves. In pairs, they drive us from the synagogue. Dear sisters and brothers, how difficult it is to say goodbye to beautiful life." Esther Sruhl, murdered on September 9, 1942. And this one. "What first struck me was a mountain of trunks, cases, rucksacks, kit bags, and parcels. Over to the left, I saw hundreds of baby carriages and pots and pans from 1,000 kitchens in 12 countries. Pathetic remnants of 1 million meals, anonymous now, for their owners would never eat again. Rudolf Werber, Auschwitz-Birkenau. But at this point, a miracle occurs. The second part of our triptych is about to unfold. It is late August, 1996. I'm better, but by no means all the way back. Someone at the museum office says casually, passing me in the hall, whatever happened to Szmul Artur Zygielbojm's final letters? And how did he commit suicide anyway? Suddenly, my instincts as a researcher start glowing and then ignite. Where are Zygielbojm's letters? How did he commit suicide? Much as he had been neglected by most everyone other than his comrades on the left, I, for one, had always identified with this great and tragic hero of the Holocaust once I learned of his existence. Born amidst poverty in Poland, in Chełm, Szmul Zygielbojm rose to become one of the greatest lights of the Polish Jewish Labor Bund, a key political party and social movement in Poland, where Jews made up 10% of the population. Forced to leave school at age 10 to become a worker in a glove-making factory and then a carpenter, Zygielbojm transformed himself into a working-class intellectual, a linguist, a journalist, taking on the pen name of Artur. Above all, he was a dynamic speaker, advocating the Bund's vision of Jews maintaining their special Yiddish identity while simultaneously taking up lives in an integrated Polish society. When the Nazis invaded in September 1939, Zygielbojm, a member of the Warsaw City Council, refused outright to serve on the Judenrat. That was the supposedly autonomous Jewish council which the Nazis established to administer the ghetto. Zygielbojm believed that such measures would not only co-opt Jews, but force them to participate in their own oppression. And so he hoped that the Jewish population could resist and not move into the ghetto at all. But fearing his imminent arrest by the Gestapo, the Bund Underground helped spirit him out of Europe. Zygielbojm soon wound up in London, where he became one of the two Jewish members of the Polish National Government in Exile. Here, Zygielbojm became the tireless voice of Polish Jewry, using his secret courier links to convey news of the emerging Holocaust to the world. In fact, it was he who revealed the secret Bund report, the very first news that the Nazis were not killing Jews helter-skelter, but had a concerted plan for mass murder. But the world only listened with half an ear. On May 12, 1943, just after the miserable failure of the Anglo-American Bermuda Conference to provide any hope of rescue, "We've had enough from these wailing Jews," the British Deputy Foreign Minister had said in a memo. And upon Zygielbojm learning that his second wife, Manya, and little boy Artek had been murdered, along with his comrades in the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, Szmul Artur Zygielbojm took his own life. But he did so as his last great gesture of activism, leaving behind letters and telegrams of protest for his comrades to discover and disseminate to world leaders and the world press. I wanted to find these letters. And so I made phone calls around the world, talking to old Bund comrades, none of whom seemed to know where his letters were or even how he actually committed the deed. One friend thought he had taken gas so as to die like his brethren in the death camps. Another thought he had poisoned himself on the very steps of the British Parliament, his final incredibly moving letters of protest and suicide pinned to his body. None of this was true. As I wrote later in the Jewish foreword, to my great surprise, my sleuthing led me right back to New York and my own backyard, to the YIVO Treasure House, the Yiddish Institute for Scholarly Study. As I started plowing through boxes stuffed with documents and artifacts, uncovering first one unexpected treasure, then another, my hands, my whole body began literally to tremble. I came upon blue postal telegrams, which Zygielbojm had sent only 2 months before his suicide. The pasted strips, all in capitals, urgent and unabashed, crying out with inescapable immediacy about the earlier short effort of revolt in Warsaw in January 1943, 4 months before the famous one. And they did in those days, as they did in those days, the word stop appears repeatedly in the place of a period, but with unintended effect. first page of the telegram. Received today cable dated February 7th, January. Germans started liquidation of remnants of Warsaw Ghetto. Stop. Jews resisted tens of Germans and a few hundred Jews killed. Stop. After 3 days, Germans stopped action, taking away 6,000 Jews. Stop. All over Poland, liquidation proceedings. Stop. Alarm the world. Stop. Apply Pope for official intervention and the Allies for extraordinary steps against Germans in the Allied countries. Stop. We suffered terribly. The remaining few hundred thousand Jews threatened with immediate annihilation. Only you can rescue us. Stop. Responsibility towards history throws upon you. Szmul Zygielbojm. I found the items you've already seen so far, and then I found this, signed in blue ink with his characteristic flourish. His last letter of farewell and protest to his beloved Bund comrades, left as a message intended to be telegraphed by those discovering his body. This is to take leave and say goodbye to all comrades and all people I love. Stop. The very remnants of our people in Poland are perishing today. I was unable to save a single soul of them. Stop. I have a debt to pay to all I left behind when escaped from Warsaw in 1940. Stop. The last of our comrades in Warsaw have just died in the heroic resistance they carried on since April 18th. I cannot survive them. I belong to them. Stop. I am going away as a protest against the democratic nation and governments not having taken any steps at all to stop the complete extermination of the Jewish people in Poland. Perhaps my death will cause what I didn't succeed while alive, that concrete action should be taken at last to save the less than 300,000 Jews who remain by now in Poland out of 3.5 million. Stop. It is the very last minute to do it. Stop. I thank you all for the happiness you gave me during the long years we lived, worked, and fought together. I love you all. Stop. Long live the Bund. Signed in ink, Szmul Zygielbojm. Zygielbojm left instructions on how his death should be publicized. He also left instructions on what to do with his body. Despite Jewish law, Zygielbojm had chosen to be cremated so that he would die in the manner of his wife, his child, and the rest of his Jewish people, whom he felt he had abandoned by leaving Poland for London. This is what Szmul Artur first got for his troubles in New York. Can you read it? No? Why not? Oh, I see. It is so tiny, it's buried amidst all this small print. Here, let me help you. London, May 14th. Szmul Zygielbojm, representative of the Polish National Council of the Polish Jewish Socialist Party, died here Wednesday at the age of 46. Mr. Zygielbojm, who left Warsaw a step ahead of the Gestapo, played a heroic part against the invading German army as a member of the Lord Mayor's Committee. His wife, family, and other relatives perished at the hands of the Nazis in the Warsaw Ghetto, and it is known that he had been extremely depressed at his inability to do anything to save Polish Jewry from mass murder. Ah, I thought, so the newspapers knew after all, in 7-point type. And then at Evo, I found the London coroner's report, Zygielbojm's death certificate. Now we would know exactly how he committed the deed. Cause of death, sodium amytal poisoning, self-administered, did kill himself while the balance of his mind was disturbed. Talk about understatement. This is worth than the Times' tiny obituary. It is utterly ahistorical and unpolitical. It sounds like the last lonely act of an isolated atom, and not what it actually was, the final attempt by an activist to awaken the world, even as his living connections to his brethren have been cut one by one. Finally, I found this precious relic, the very eyeglasses through which this indefatigable Jewish socialist visionary had looked out upon the world. They were found on his desk, not far from his body, broken, as perhaps history requires them to be. Well, I returned to the museum headquarters, barging into a conference, and announced my discovery to the disbelief and amazement of our director. Then I burst into uncontrollable sobs. we realized immediately that we would have to redesign the entire exhibition gallery on world Jewish response to the Holocaust in order to encompass this moving and historic find. Oh, and I decided to include in the exhibit as well a wonderfully dynamic photo portrait of the extended Zygielbojm clan. I think Manya, his wife, is to his left with the scarf, just above the head of little Artek, the little boy murdered in the ghetto. Here are some of Zygielbojm's many brothers and his sister. And there was also this little unidentified girl in the middle. As for the last of that depression I told you about, those dark fingers that held me in their cold, unyielding grip, you know, as soon as I found this material, in a snap, snap, it disappeared. It lifted from me like dark wings, disintegrating into the blazing glory of autumn. Zygielbojm had done it for me, of course, not simply finding the evidence of his death, but the indelible record of his life energy, his incandescent example, his activism, his sacrifice, all of which reminded me of why I was doing the work to which I devoted myself all these long and painful, and yes, those exhilarating years. Thank you, Szmul Artur. You said in your last letter of protest that you weren't able to save a single soul, that perhaps your death would accomplish what you couldn't accomplish in life. Well, in my case, it did. You reached across time and space and you restored my life. I, Jud Newborn, am a Jew by culture and heritage and by some inadequate degree of observance. You were a Bund socialist, but I am reminded now of the words of that Hasidic master, the Baal Shem Tov. God's gift is a world that is new to us every morning, and a person should believe he is reborn each day. But wait, I told you this was a story of three lives, didn't I? Not just two. How can we complete our triptych? Does it hold together? Well, to my great surprise, in the spring of 1998, I received a handwritten letter from a brilliant psychoanalyst living in New York who had seen my article about Szmul Zygielbojm in the foreword. "I thank you for uncovering the truth about my uncle's death," she wrote. "His heroism was beyond what we know today. I was born in Chelm," she continued, "and left at the age of 10 for South Africa, where I lived and became a physician. I knew Artur, Manya, and Artek well. I have lived most of my life in Artur's enormous heroic shadow." The letter was signed Dr. Leah Zygielbojm Davidson. Well, several phone conversations revealed to me that the author of these letters was one of America's most prominent psychoanalysts, and not just any kind of psychoanalyst, but of all things, a cross-cultural psychoanalyst working at the prestigious White Institute, founded in the 1940s by the great Erich Fromm and Harry Stack Sullivan. I can't begin to tell you what it meant for me to connect with someone inspired by cultural anthropology, my own calling, and a living relative of Szmul Zygielbojm. We quickly became fast friends. We connected on some mysterious level that would astound us both if it hadn't felt so natural. It is as if we had known each other our whole lives, and who knows, Leah thought, perhaps in another life as well. In fact, not too long after my discovery, I attended a major ballroom dance competition in which Dr. Davidson competed with the best of them, and I do mean competed. Then age 72, Dr. Davidson was an accomplished dancer of near professional status. She took away numerous top prizes after dancing almost nonstop during 3 days and 110 separate competitive heats. And each heat showcasing yet another classic dance at various levels of difficulty. Well, backtracking, I arranged for Dr. Davidson to see the museum and the special Zygielbojm exhibit. And something incredible happened, another miracle. When Dr. Davidson saw the photograph of the extended Zygielbojm clan prominently displayed, she discovered herself in the picture, surrounded by the embrace of her family, including those long lost. Leah was the unidentified little girl in the middle, the one who looks out so soberly onto a world in turmoil. Now, Dr. Davidson, as a psychoanalyst, was honest enough to acknowledge, as I have, something deeply personal. She had suffered from a terrible case of survivor guilt since 1939. That was the year she had gathered up this photograph among other little mementos of her life in Chelm, when she fled with her father, Zygielbojm's brother, to South Africa. Later, Dr. Davidson came to New York and donated this photograph, among other items, to the YIVO archives, where it was placed unbeknownst to her amid the then hidden archives of Szmul Zygielbojm himself. When Leah saw the artifacts you have just seen in the museum, as well as her own photograph, she experienced a profound welling up from the diaphragm, she said, a cry combining all at once the emotions of grief, joy, anger, and most importantly, of relief. This tremendous psychoanalyst, who had helped so many others all her life long, experienced that day a personal catharsis. "I no longer need ask for what purpose I am alive," she wrote afterwards, "since the answer is clear within this glass case of which I have, by so-called chance or contingency, become a part. It is to bear witness." Well, we have nearly reached our conclusion. But in order to get there, we must once again take a little trip back in time and space and tell a little fairy tale. There was once a little town in Poland, a warm and vibrant shtetl, Leah's shtetl. Its name was Chełm. Let me read to you from the Gazetteer. "Lublin province, 40 miles east-southeast of Lublin, rail junction, trade center, manufacturing, brewing, distilling, flour and sawmilling, brickworking, ancient Jewish community possibly dating from 12th century, legendary site of humorous stories about Chełm sages, Hasidic dynasty from 19th century, Jewish inhabitants, 1931, 13,537, or nearly 50% of the entire population, mass deportations, May 21st, 1942. Final liquidation of Jewish community, November 6, 1942. Death camp, Sobibor. Or as survivor Yisrael Aschendorf wrote in the Book of Memory, written by the town's few survivors, the Chełm Yizkor book, "There is one Chełm which was the world of the ancestors, which is now the Chełm of the dead. That Chełm posts year in, year out with a powerful current of Jewish social life. Chełm was famous, of course, as a legendary home of the so-called wise people of Chełm, the simple-souled sages who mistakenly thought themselves wise beyond belief. According to legend, God gave an angel two bags, one filled with wisdom and one the other with folly. 'Scatter them evenly over the peoples of the earth,' God commanded the angel. But at one point, while the angel was flying, the bag of folly suddenly split open and emptied out in its entirety over the roofs and heads of Chełm. The foolishness of the wise men of Chełm," Aschendorf writes, "isn't the kind of foolishness that is associated with ill will, but rather the sort that accompanies well-meaning naivete. The people of Chełm aren't in the habit of deceiving others. They always fall victim to their own inventions. It is in that sense that they are similar to Don Quixote. Their folly reveals the soul of Chełm, a soul which yearns for beauty, which is full of mercy, which possesses faith, which seeks justice. Such a noble character have the wise people of Chełm." Hundreds of Jewish cities and towns in Poland, Aschendorf continues, have been destroyed, but the Chełm of the spirit remains unvanquished. Chełm was created by the Jewish people, and it will live on with the Jewish people. In our exodus from Poland, we took along so much pain and tragedy that we certainly need a bit of joy as well. Let us therefore tell and retell our tales of the cheerful and naive Jews of Chełm. When Dr. Leah Davidson danced, she danced not only for herself. Foolish, wise, and splendid in her fine feathered gown and colorful high heels, this 72-year-old Jewish Ariel gestured, dipped, whirled, and spun to the strains and steps of the samba, the tango, the flamboyant bolero, and even the jitterbug. And when she went up to receive her gold trophies from the judges, there was but one thought that flowed silently through her mind. She told it to me. "I dance for all those who can no longer dance. I dance for my shtetl." If Leah were only here with us, I would introduce you to her as our living link to those foolish, wise, and wonderful Jews of Chełm who are no more, and to Szmul Artur, our postmodern tzaddik of the Holocaust. And then I would say to her, Schwesterle, Mamenju, we're facing some troubling times again with rising anti-Semitism and the future of democracy uncertain. What should we do? And you know what she'd say? We have to fight, but let's also not forget to dance. God's gift, the Baal Shem Tov tells us, is a world that is new to us every morning, and a person should believe he is reborn each day. And that's the miracle I've come to tell you about today. Thank you all, a shenem dank. And here now is Art Zygielbojm, the grandson of Szmul Artur.
Thank you very much, Judd. I'm honored to be here. Let me start by talking about my family. I'm the grandson of Szmul Artur Zygielbojm and his first wife, Golda. Their son, Joseph, my father, was born in 1919. My father and his father were attempting to get to Warsaw after the war started. They were in a column of refugees that was strafed by a German fighter plane, and they were separated. My grandfather never learned that his son had survived. My father joined the Jewish partisans and spent the war fighting the Nazis. He found out that his father had survived when his unit took over a local German headquarters. He found a German newspaper with an article about the suicide of a Jew in London. My mother was born in 1924. She was in Nazi slave labor camps from the age of 16 to 19. They met in Poland after the war and married. They immigrated to the US in December of 1946, and I was born in February of 1947. My mother spoke many times with a chuckle about how hard it was to cross the North Atlantic in a displaced person's boat in the middle of winter while 7 months pregnant. My late brother Paul came along in 1950. This picture shows us in the early 1960s at our home in California. My dad worked for NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, a place I was later to spend 30 years. I've given many talks about my grandfather, my family, and the Holocaust. After much reflection, I've come to some conclusions. One thing I don't want to do is give another woe is us presentation. Yes, Jews suffered mightily over millennia. The Nazi Holocaust was the latest and most vicious attack on our people and its culture. As Jews, we are told to never forget, and that's important. But what is it we should always remember? First, the Holocaust didn't start overnight. There was over a decade of messaging, discriminatory actions, and governmental structural changes that allowed the Holocaust to happen. There were good Germans who, by the time they realized something was wrong, were powerless to overcome it. Always remember that any action that discriminates against any group of people, like Jews, Blacks, transgendered, any group of people, represents the proverbial slippery slope that will eventually hurt all of us. Always act to protect your freedom and the legal system on which it is based. Second, remember who we are. 90% of Polish Jews died in the Holocaust, 90%. What struck me in the past few years is the realization that I am one of the descendants of the few Polish Jews who survived. I feel a sacred obligation to make sure that my life makes a difference. At the end of my life, I need to be able to reflect that the world might be a little bit better place for my having been here. In light of Judd's beautiful remarks, I want to point out that we need to celebrate the strength of Judaism and its people, rebirth, reborn. We need to celebrate that we have not only survived, but that we continue to contribute to all facets of human endeavors, the arts, medicine, science, engineering, law and justice, so many fields. We need to remember the strength of the Jews like my grandfather. In 1998, the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum dedicated an exhibit, to my grandfather. At the event, the Polish government presented him with the highest medal they would award posthumously. I received it for the family. And at that event, I met Jan Karski, the spy who brought news from Poland to my grandfather. I met Marek Edelman, one of the leaders of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. I had a chance to get to know my grandfather better from the people who last talked and communicated with him. The Russian poet Yevgeny Yevtushenko wrote about the killing fields outside of Kyiv, Ukraine, where 24,000 Jews were slaughtered, over Baba Yar rustles the wild grass. The trees look threatening, like judges, and everything is one silent cry. My grandfather's suicide notes stated, "I cannot be silent, but by my death, I wish to make my final protest against the passivity with which the world is looking on and permitting the extermination of the Jewish people." I'm proud to be here today. Through events such as this one, I know that the cry of Szmul Zygielbojm is not silent. Thank you.
Thank you, Art. And thank you, Judd, for your beautiful and very touching presentations. I'd like to invite the audience to continue putting their questions into the chat box. I'm sure you have a lot of questions to ask. And my colleague and friend, Sharon Douglas, will be collecting your questions and asking them of our speakers. Right now, I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we have upcoming at the Susan Mendes Foundation, and that'll give you a few moments to collect your thoughts and continue typing in your questions. So we have three more Sundays until we take a break for the Jewish holidays of Passover. And so basically we have next week, the 12th, and then the 19th, and then the 26th, and then we'll take a break until April 23rd. So next week, we are looking at Germany and the efforts today of German young people all across the country to come to terms with their country's history. And there's a very developed, vibrant remembrance culture in Germany, and you learn some very inspirational stories. It's definitely a program that will inspire you. That is a free program. The following week is another free program, and that's called Yankee Resistance, the story of a small Connecticut town that challenged the Nazis and won. And that's the story of Southbury, Connecticut, and how they fought against the German-American Bund that was buying up property all across the United States in the 1930s, before the advent of World War II. They were laying the groundwork for the propaganda war that was to follow. And so this little town in Connecticut was invaded by this German-American Bund that bought a piece of property at the top of the hill. And the residents of that town ran these people out of town through every means possible. And it's really a delightful story. There's a film we'll show that was made by the Southbury, Connecticut Historical Society. And that's another free program. In 3 weeks, we're showing a film that had a profound effect on me personally when it first came out. The film is Into the Arms of Strangers, and it's the story of the Kinder Transport. This is the film that won the Academy Award for Best Documentary in the year 2000, and it's stayed with me ever since, and I was so delighted when the filmmaker agreed to let us show this film. And so you will meet him. His name is Mark Jonathan Harris. And joining us from England is a survivor of the Kinder Transport, 93-year-old Lady Milena Grenfell Baines. And she was little Milena Fleischmann from Prague. When she first arrived in England, she settled in England, she became English, and you'll want to meet her. So that's in 3 weeks' time. So right now we're going to show you a little trailer for that film, Into the Arms of Strangers.
Thank you. My father said, Mommy and I cannot leave, but you're going to leave. You're going to England, he said.
I mean, this is all I knew, and we had to give it up.
Every parent promised their child, we will soon come and follow. How otherwise did the parents get the little children onto the trains?
They did what most of us don't do. They had the grace to take in a child.
My dear good darling parents, I feel very safe here. If only I was not so very scared about your safety.
My biggest problem was to try and get my parents out.
We yearn to get away from here. It'll be a difficult task for you.
Before long, I had a list of people whom I, at 10 years old, had promised to save from Hitler.
I remember trying hard to believe that we really will come back.
In 1938, I got out of Germany in the Kinder transport. I was meant to survive. I look at my children and my grandchildren, I know there was a purpose to my life.
Sharon, the floor is yours now for the Q&A.
The questions came in a little late, but I got them all. I want to thank, of course, all the relatives of Shmuel, Judith Tellerman, whose mother was first cousins with Shmuel, and Arta, the daughter of Reuven. If people were watching the movie that was shown when you got your ticket, you saw that Reuven was the brother of Shmuel, and you also saw Kosky. Gentlemen, I'm going to have some questions for both Judd as well as Arthur. Would you like to speak to the movie, Judd or Arthur? Are there any?
No. I do have a comment.
Go ahead.
I think the movie is wonderful, very moving, and we're very grateful to the producer for allowing us to show it. I just want to make a comment about historical chronology. Jan Karski, who is in the movie, is of course very celebrated as a Polish non-Jewish diplomat who saw what was happening in the Warsaw Ghetto and was smuggled out of Europe in order to tell the world what was going on. But actually, it was Szmul Zygielbojm who first told the world of the mass murder of Jews as a systematic enterprise. And that was in the Bund report in May 1942, several months before Karski came to London. Shmuel had radio and courier contacts to the Jewish Bund, and they sent him what was called the Bund Report. And he broadcast on the BBC that 700,000 Jews had been murdered so far. And it was, of course, even more than that. He may have been referring just to the Poland. And then a few months later, Jan Karski came through, and Shmuel was the first one to debrief him when he came. And Karski delivered a message to Shmuel from the Leon Feiner, who was one of the leaders of the Bund. And the message was a very terrible one. They were in such desperation that he was told the following message: let them refuse drink, that is the Jewish leaders in the Western world. Let them refuse food. Let them die. Let them die a slow death. Let the humankind watch. Maybe this will move their conscience. Karski told me that Shmuel began to walk back and forth in great agitation and said, they'll think I'm crazy if I go on a hunger strike or kill myself. Karski felt very, very guilty later that he had conveyed that message, although he was in no way responsible for what Zygielbojm ultimately did. But Zygielbojm also wrote letters, as Korsky did, but before him, to world leaders, including Winston Churchill and Roosevelt. So I just want to give Zygielbojm the credit that he is due for bringing the first news of the Holocaust to the West. That's my comment.
Judd, there is a question in the chat from Deborah James. What did the exiled Polish government do in London? How long did it operate?
I'm not too well informed on the actions of the Polish government. To my understanding, they operated through the period of the war once they located themselves as at the headquarters in London. And I think what they mainly did was public relations, trying to spread the word. Zygielbojm, in his last letter to the Polish president, which is a terribly moving letter, which Art quoted from, he said that they weren't doing enough to draw attention to what was happening to the Jews. So that's what I can tell you about the Polish government in exile. And thank God there was a Jewish representative there.
And from Susan Feingold, are there any earlier letters to the world from Zygielbojm before his suicide letter?
Well, if you're asking me, I don't know of specifically of any letters to, I do know that he wrote, I don't know where they are, but I know he wrote to world leaders and tried to alert them. I don't know where those letters are, but I'd certainly like to see them. They must be in some archive. And he wrote personal letters back and forth to all sorts of people that are moving.
And to Arthur, Nina asked, what is an explanation of your family tree? How do you fit in to the family?
Kind of in the center. No, I'm kidding. My grandfather, Szmul Zygielbojm, was my grandfather. My grandfather had two wives. His first one was Golda. His second one was, why is this leaving my mind, Manya? And my father was born to Golda in Szmul Zygielbojm. So that's how I'm related. He did write other letters. I may have some in my archives here, Judd. I'll do some looking. He was very prolific as a writer, and told many, many stories, especially about his escape from Poland. When the Nazis decided to go after him. And you don't need to talk about that. I had a chance to meet Jan Karski, as I said, at the Holocaust Memorial Museum and at the reception at the Polish Embassy afterwards. And we had a chance to talk. And it's interesting. He related exactly the same story to me about how my grandfather became so agitated and upset. I've heard that story. I've seen it portrayed in there's a new movie that's out in Poland called The Death of Zygielbojm. And they do have a distributor here for the US, and hopefully it'll come out. And it depicts Karski and my grandfather. And the amazing thing about it is it's exactly the same as what Karski told me that occurred. So watch out for that. Hopefully it'll be out someday soon. Hope that answers the question.
Yeah, this is very interesting because on the chat, we have someone by the name of Allison Goldbaum, who has said, I'm glad that Szmul got recognition he deserved. I was a student of Abe Zygielbojm in the 1970s at the Los Angeles campus of Hebrew Union College. He was an inspiration to me. That's wonderful.
That was my uncle Abba and Tema. Well, and they played a large role in our lives when we were younger. So we knew, as kids, we always called him Abba, and that's what he always was. And he was a very, very interesting man, a scholar. We learned a lot from him.
And David Rosenberg says that I was the chair of the committee that established the plaque in London in memory of Zygielbojm. And when it was unveiled, that was the last time we saw Arthur and other family members. So we're pleased to see him again here. It's quite a story attached to the establishment of the plaque, which includes Esther and Meyer, who were in the film. Wow.
It was an amazing event in London, and we much enjoyed. I remember meeting him, and I The plaque was amazing. It was also amazing having dinner with the Polish ambassador to Great Britain afterwards and getting to talk about what went on. I'll say very quickly, one of my favorite stories from that event, and I'll let Olivia raise her hand if I'm going on too long, but when we flew into the country, you fill out those little cards that you say where you're from, your nationality. My son said, "What's my nationality?" And I said, "American." And, "Well, what's my citizenship?" "America." And he said, "Oh, that's funny." The ambassador talked about Jews and he talked about Poles. And I said, "Well, come on now, isn't my grandfather a Pole?" And the ambassador kind of chuckled. And he, "You know, my grandfather fought in World War I for Poland. You know, isn't he a Pole?" Well, it ends up in Europe, and that may still be true in much of Europe today, your legal documents say your nationality is the ethnic group you belong to. Your citizenship is where you have your political allegiance. So it's codified to mark people as different. My grandfather's passport would have said his nationality was Jewish, his citizenship was Polish. Is there any question about what could go wrong if you designate people as being different?
Wow.
Sharon,
perhaps one more question and then we'll proceed to our final thoughts.
The one question that I was quite interested in is, how do you see Zygielbojm as a Shakespearean tragic figure?
If you're asking me,
I'll ask you.
Well, usually a Shakespearean tragic figure is of noble birth, and I'd like to say that Zygielbojm was of the most modest birth, but he had the most noble character. A Shakespearean tragic hero is wounded by some traumatic experience, and certainly Zygielbojm was wounded, but persevered until he could no longer continue. If a Shakespearean figure has a tragic flaw, the flaw may have been in Zygielbojm's own mind that he didn't accomplish what he could have, because it was unlikely that he could have accomplished what he wanted anyway. Nobody knew what could be done to wake up the Jews, the Allies. He did as much as he could possibly do. And it's tragic that
one more question, Olivia. Yes. In this world full of stories and statistics about the rise of anti-Semitism, gentlemen, in the US and the world, would you both like to comment on what more can be done, perhaps, to reduce this evil? And you, author, as a scientist, do you have some thoughts about the kind of thinking that leads to Holocaust denial? Those were my questions. So if you spend 2 minutes on them, if you can, it would be wonderful.
Well, I think the Holocaust, you have to understand why the Holocaust occurred. Why are we discriminated against? Well, for one thing, we're scapegoats. When leadership is trying to build power, they create a problem and they say the problem is caused by those people. It will help you take care of those people. So the Holocaust denial is another way of saying we're going to pin something on a bunch of people. They're the cause of our problems and you just got to get rid of them. I thought about this a lot. What can we do? We say never forget. The piece that's missing is, so what do you do about it?
Right.
And if the police are coming to the house of your neighbor and taking them away because they happen to be Jews, and are you going to go out there with your little pop pistol and say, "Don't do that, that's not good"? No, you're not going to risk your family. You're not going to risk your life to save them. So it has to be much more basic. We've got to recognize, you know, my mother always said that you never hate somebody because of the group they belong to. If they need to be hated, hate them because of the person that they are. Never identify somebody with a group. Treat people as individuals. If we believe that and can make it happen where we guarantee the rights and the freedoms of everyone, things like the Holocaust don't occur.
And yes. I think that, Arthur, there's a little video clip you'd like to show us. So why don't you introduce it?
I will be happy to do that.
Terrific.
My grandfather's life and death were dedicated to his people. His death was unbearably sad and his anguish was real. There's a side to him that you rarely see presented. In this video, you'll see the only images I have ever seen of my grandfather smiling. This film was taken at a Jewish children's camp before the war. He is the man with a long tie. Again, following on Judd's excellent remarks on rebirth and renewal, let me point out that my grandfather's suicide letters included two sentences that are rarely noted. In the horrible desperation of his last moments, he wrote, "I wish that the remaining handful of several millions of Polish Jews could live to see the liberation of a new world of freedom and justice and socialism. I believe that such a Poland will arise and that such a world will come. Listen to the message. It's a statement of hope." That is the essence of my grandfather and of our people.
And of Anne Frank.
Amen.
Great. Now, John, are there any closing words you would like to say to our audience?
Yes, I would like to say that no one could have been more dynamic and determined than Szmul Zygielbojm. But the world didn't listen for so many reasons. But let's learn from that, and also from that grandson of Holocaust survivors, Volodymyr Zelensky of Ukraine, and commit ourselves to making sure, as democracy is threatened, that, and as Art said, that the world listens today when needed, but it also takes action. And that means acting in solidarity with our major Jewish organizations, contacting our political representatives, taking action, pressuring. That's what we need to do.
Wonderful.
So we will be playing out this program with some music, but before we do, I want to spend this moment to thank today's event sponsors. That's Mimi and Marvin Sandler. Thank you so much for enabling so many of the people to be here today. Thank you to Sharon Douglas and the Anne Frank Center USA for co-sponsoring and for moderating, Sharon. And certainly to our illustrious speakers, Dr. Jud Newborn, Dr. Art Zygielbojm. Thank you for sharing your personal thoughts and inspiring us today. So, audience, I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day, and here is some music to ring in your ears.